Indian History for Prelims 2020. This is part two of the Ancient History, Political, Administrative and Socio-Economical Aspects. And in this video, we will cover the Vedic Age till Mahajanapada period and some other minor topics. So let's start with the Aryans. Aryans, who were Aryans? Aryans as a race, as a racial concept, you must recall that it has been rejected. It is no longer used as a racial concept, particularly after the Second World War and the Hitler's Nazi party antics. Okay, so Aryans were these Central Asian nomads who were known for the common literary tradition, and they moved in waves towards Asia, that is Middle East, in the rest of the Asia, that is Middle East, and at Iran, and later on India, and also to the various parts of the Europe. And that's why the Indo-European languages are similar to the ancient Indian language, that is the Sanskrit, right? So there is a common literary tradition, there is a common, and ancient Iranian text Jandavesta is an Aryan text, Aryan language text, and there is quite a bit of similarity with the Rig Veda. Now, early Vedic life, it is distinguished by the Vedic literature, Vedic age, and early Vedic life and later Vedic age, two parts has been divided depending upon the Rig Veda and the rest of the three Veda. So the Rig Veda time period is known as the early Vedic period, and the rest is the later three Veda, when three Veda were supposedly composed and given via oral tradition, okay, by the god himself to the sages of the time, is the later Vedic times. You all are aware of it because this is a revision video, and I can safely presume that you all know about the basics, and this is just for the helping you guys recall and refresh it up. So about the Vedic literature and the religious aspect, I will cover separately in this video. Primarily, I will cover the political aspect, economical aspect, etc., as mentioned in the title itself. And so, one of the earliest references via inscriptional evidence of the Aryans is from the Bogaz Gui inscription, as well as the Kasavai inscription of the Middle East. And there is a treaty between the Mitanni rulers, etc., Hittite tribes, etc., mentioned, that is not important for you. Important thing for you to remember is the four Vedic pantheon gods, four Vedic gods, Indra, Mitra, Varuna and Asatya, are mentioned in that particular inscription. There are a number of original home theories are also there about the Aryans. What is the original home of Aryans? Some right wingers claim that Aryans were the indigenous people only. Some people claim that Aryans were not indigenous. In fact, they came from the Central Asia, which is the correct one I mentioned earlier. In which the views of the Swami Dayananda Saraswati is there, Swami Vivekananda is also there. Some believe that that they came from the Bal Gangadhar Tilak is also there, that they came from North Pole. Some believe that yes, they indeed, Swami Dayananda Saraswati came from the North Pole. Bal Gangadhar Tilak said that at that time North Pole was in India. Swami Vivekananda said that they were from Afghanistan, but at that time India, Afghanistan was a part of India. And a number of such other theories are there. And I already mentioned about that they came in waves in India too. The earliest wave come around 1600-1500 BC, which was synonymous with the decline of the Indus Valley Civilization. In Indus Valley Civilization video, in that is part 1 of the Ancient Indian Revision, I mentioned about the Aryan Invasion Theory, if you guys have watched that video. So Indus Valley Civilizations and the coming of the Aryans is quite a contemporary event. Okay, so in the starting, Aryans came, and there, apart from Aryans, there is mention of Dasas and Dasyus. So who were Dasas and who were Dasyus? Who were Dasas and who were Dasyus? It is considered that Dasas were the Aryans itself, one of the earlier waves, earlier those Aryans who came earlier, okay, they were the Dasas, and Dasyu was the original inhabitants of India. Some claim that they were the IVC people, industrialization people, but still it is a dispute. I already mentioned about the common Aryan languages, the racial concept being negated nowadays, and the literary meaning of the Aryan, Arya, is the high born of respectable family belonging to noble family, noble person. And in India, their reason of their success was the horse-drawn chariots, because the Central Asian always had good quality horses at their disposal because of the large grasslands, and cow and horse were most important thing in their life. They didn't practice agriculture, primarily they were cattle herder. Moreover, they didn't have any knowledge of iron. Yes, they didn't have any knowledge of iron. They only had the weapons of the copper or bronze, but they were not that much into the trade, etc. They were the fierce warriors because of the horse. They were the horse drawn chariot as well as the horse mounted archers, etc. Copper was known as ayas, and later on iron, when started to be used by the later Vedic people, it was known as Krishna Ayas or Shyam Ayas. There is mention of the Panchajana as well as the Dasarajana battle. There is five Panchajana, iron, five non-iron and tribes got together under sage Vishwamitra, and then they fought against the Sudas of supported by Vashishtha, in which the Sudas won. Das again, then Panchajana, there is another battle in which Divadasa of Bharata clan defeated the Sambara chief, the local chief known as Sambar. Thus, we can see the political life as well as the more important thing is the early Aryans' area of influence. So they occupied the area of the present day Pakistani Punjab and modern Indian Punjab and Haryana, as well as Western Uttar Pradesh, what is called as Saptasindhu region. They didn't move towards the present day Gangetic Plains. It was still very highly forested area, and I mentioned earlier that they were the cattle herders. The agricultural knowledge was there, but agriculture was secondary, and because we cattle herders, lack of grassland in India, they focused upon the shifting agriculture only. And importance of cow was so much that it is known as aganya, not to be killed, and the times measure godhuli, these terms, gavyuti distance term, gavishti search for it, goganna guest, these terms emerge from cow. Goganna, that is one for whom beef is to be served. Gotra, you all know about the gotra surname clan. Gotra, cow pen, gomat, and duhitri. These are the other terms, duhitri, jo doodh nikalegi, daughter. Their agricultural knowledge was good. Plowshare was known to them, I already mentioned. The spoked wheel, one of the war tactics in which wheels of the chariots were spoked. About the polity of early Vedic time. Let's look at the Rajan was a chief. It was not a supreme leader. He was not something who has great centralized power. In fact, in early times, he was elected by the Samiti, which was an executive kind of thing, was elected by the village assembly, larger village assembly of Sabha. And Vidhata was a distribution ceremony in which Sabha and Vidhata, women were able to participate. Gana was a drinking and dancing ceremony. Women were not allowed in this as well as in Samiti. Then Purohit, the officials. Purohit, as you know, what is the purpose of Purohit and Anumati. Vrajapati was in charge of the grassland because of the importance of cow. Kullappa was the head of a family, a larger family, Gramani. Gram was set, a cow was set, and the family. It's having kinship units. So, Jan was the tribe under Rajanya. Jan had divided into two parts. Under Rajanya, the elite lineage and common lineage or Vish, the larger tribe. Okay, these are the two parts of the two branches of Jan or the tribe. Then there was clan, kul, under Kulappa. Then Graha or individual family. Right, and usually a gram has kinship units. People of same kul, family lineages used to inhabit it. And Sangram means when two villages come together to fight, usually for cow. Varna system was not there during the Aryans, during the Rigvedic times. Only Aryans and Dasas differentiation was there in the society. Till the Purushasukta hymn of the 10th mandal, which is of a later period, at the end of, it was composed at the end of the early Vedic age. Purushasukta hymns give that from the parts of the Brahma, four Varna emerged: Brahmans, Vaishya, Kshatriya and Shudra from feet, Vaishya from hands, Kshatriya, Brahmans from mind, etc. But that is no need to go into details of it. Society was patriarchal, although women's position was quite good. I already mentioned about the participation in Sabha and Vidhata. Moreover, women were allowed for education as well as offering of sacrifices with the husband. Although polyandry and polygamy was there, but polyandry, like the Draupadi having multiple husbands, polyandry more than one husband, polygamy more than one wife. In fact, levirate or niyoga, in case of death of the husband, marriage with the husband's younger brother, the widow remarriage was also allowed, and the marriageable age was not low. It was no child marriage was there. Samvar or choosing the husband was there. Eight forms of marriages are mentioned in the Vedic text. These including the love marriage. There was a marriage, Deva marriage, Pishach marriage, that is the marriage by abduction, etc. Marriage by giving the dowry, giving gift to the bride's father. In fact, reverse dowry, that is also. Brahmavadinis is very important. These are the women who compose the Vedic hymns. Women who compose Vedic hymns. One of the most important aspect is of the Rig Veda, about Rig Vedic position of the woman, is Brahmavadinis. There are other examples like the Gargi confronted these sage Yajnavalkya in one of the debate. Philosophical aspect of Rig Veda, this is important fact. Brahmavadinis, I mentioned about Gargi. Lopamudra, wife of sage Agastya, was there. Maitreyi, wife of sage Yajnavalkya, was also in Brahmavadini. There was also Apala, Ghosha, Sachi, etc. Then came the later Vedic time. And the later Vedic times, which started around 1000 BC, Iron Age started in north. And with the help of the iron implements, and iron weapons, there was movement towards east. Although iron implements were not used start in the beginning for the agriculture, and instead iron weapons were used only in the warfare. And there is story of Videga Madhva moving to east using the fire, thereby clearing jungles for agricultural, and the Ganges plain were occupied, and this is mentioned in Shatpath Brahmana. Moreover, now with the change, there emerged a major change in the way of life as well as the political life. The tribal character gave way to the territorial character. The distinct pottery of this time period is the painted graveware culture. Apart from this, this period is also important for the rise of the Kshatriyas and Brahmanas, and the Varna distinction became acute. Although there was no untouchability, but the position of women and that of the lowest Varna, that is Shudras, deteriorated. But Shudras were still in agricultural occupation at that time. Upanayana ceremony was followed by the under the Brahmana influence. Ritualistic religion came into being with the sacrifice and ritual. A number of the rituals for the householder, for the Rajan, for the public and private life emerged. Rituals, the person who used to do rituals, who used to do jajnas at home is known as jajman. And Nagar's faint beginnings of the civilization started, and smaller janpads started, came into being, like Ru, Panchalas, Kekaya, Koshal, Madra, Vidisha, Madra, Parajra, Punjab. Some of them were republics. They were not monarchical aspect was less as compared to the republic character of there. But neither they were totally republic nor they were totally monarchical. In fact, the monarchical character was never not in with in this time period didn't establish itself completely. Rashtra didn't step with the definite territory, didn't establish completely. Nation, a state formation, a faint beginning of the state formation happened, and then Janpada and followed by Mahajanpada, it evolved. These are the crops like Virhi or the rice, and these are the various terms like Kulal or the potter, Bishkar, the medicine man, Rathakara, the maker of Rats, Kusidin. Vidhata disappeared, the distribution, that means the distribution, the appropriation by the higher Varanas of Brahmins and Kshatriya became more and more. There were regular taxation, so there were taxation, but it was not regular. Bali and Bhaga Bali was the voluntary presents to the king, and Bhaga were the land revenue. Sangrahitri and Bhaga Duga were the official associated with its treasurers, and Bhaga Duga was the revenue collector, assessor. Ashrama system emerged. First there were three ashramas, followed by the four ashrama system emerged. Under Brahmacharya was the first stage of the ashrama life, followed by the that of the householder, then the vanaprastha, and finally sannyas. Gargi's Navalka story I mentioned earlier. Then Janpadas developed into the full-fledged states with centralized power. This happened in the 6th century BC, and three M emerged: monks, monarchs, and merchants. Merchants gave the second urbanization after Indus Valley civilization. Monarchs, I already mentioned about the political developments, there are centralized power, centralized states emerged, Mahajanpadas, Janpad, foothold of the territories as the tribal, they emerged from the earlier tribal tribal localities, and they expanded their domains and continuously tried to expand it via warfare or diplomacy, marriage alliances. Panini's Ashtadhyayi gave knowledge about this time period of Mahajanpadas. Also important for the monks, the heterodox or the unorthodox reaction against the Vedic religions, sacrificial cult in which the cattle wealth was destroyed, was getting destroyed, and it was resented by the agriculturist. At the same time, the Vaishyas and Kshatriyas also reacted against the Brahman domination. Buddhist text Digha Nikaya gave a theory of the origin of state. Okay, I already mentioned about the some republic characters, but they were tribal characters were more as compared to the monarchical character. That's why they are considered as the Gana Sangha. Parishad, an assembly emerged. Parishad, a close confidant, an assembly of the close confidant, a cabinet-like thing. Regular taxation emerged during this period, so is the standing army rather than a militia by the lesser chieftains. And the reasons of the second urbanization was the surplus, as merchant, that trade resulted in the same region that was in the Indus Valley civilization. So urbanization, the trade centers emerged, towns emerged, people from the various parts used to come there. And paddy transplantations in the eastern India, in particular, rice transplantations emerged as a major region, or the extra surplus, the rice production, extra food production. Ghapatis was an important term for the rich peasants. I already mentioned that Buddhism and Jainism, etc., will be covered in a separate video for the religion, as well as the Brahmanism, including the Shaivism, Vaishnavism, Samartha tradition, etc. So these are the some of the Mahajanapadas from the northwest, the Kambojas and Gandharas. Then the Kuru Panchala. Panchala has the two capitals. Kuru is the Hastinapur as the capital. The Panchalas has two capitals, the Kosala. Then Malla Republic, as Virichi also has the republic characters. There are Madra in the Punjab. Actually, there were smaller republics were also there. The Kashi was initially a small village, then became a Mahajanapada. Kosala gave Kashi to Magadha as dowry. Anga was the Bhagalpur region, and sometimes the Banga, Vanga is the this area. Then Shurasena is the Mathura region, Matsya is the Jaipur region, Vatsa is the Allahabad region. Sometimes Vatsa is considered as the Pandavas, established by Pandavas Vanshas. Avanti in the central India, Cheti in the Chhattisgarh region, Asmaka or Asaka in the Nashik region of the Maharashtra. Magdhan ascendancy. Now, what were the regions of the Magdhan ascendancy? Why Magdha emerged as the supreme, as the main Mahajanapadas out of these Mahajanapadas? Why? One reason was that they were location of their capitals, like initially the Rajgira, later Pataliputra, was a strategic location, was a strategic area. Moreover, they were close to the iron ore resources. And they were in the Middle Gangetic Plains, fertile area, riverine trade was possible, and their character of their rulers was, as well as population, was unorthodox. Then they got some great rulers starting from Bimbisar, Rajashatru, etc. First dynasty, great dynasty of Magdhas was Haryanka, in which the Bimbisar, also known as Senya, who captured the eastern Mahajanapada of Anga. And along with this marriage alliances, it expanded his domain. His son Ajatashatru killed himself. That's why parricide is killer of his father. With his father, with wars against the Kosala, with which he won the Kashi, and also with the Richis Vaishali, Ajatashatru. Amrapali was contemporary of Ajatashatru, and all these three were contemporary of Buddha. Udayin was the son of Ajatashatru, who made Kataliputra as capital. Then after these, let me tell you here about the contemporary ruler of Buddha. Although I will cover that in, but here with this map you can easily understand. There was one Udayin Vatsa, king of Vatsa kingdom. Vatsa Mahajanapada was also contemporary of Buddha, apart from the Bimbisara Ajatashatru Amrapali. And Chanda Pradyota Mahasena of Avanti. He was also contemporary of Buddha. Then came the Shishunaga dynasty. Shishunaga dynasty temporarily shifted capital to the Nandas. Apart from that, nothing much happened there. Then the most important dynasty before Mauryans and the Magadha was the Nandas, which was a known Kshatriya dynasty and considered as the first empire builder. Mahapadma Nanda, the Ekarat, or the sole sovereign. And he attacked Kalinga, brought a Jina image, and he was followed by Dhanananda. And Dhanananda was then removed by the Chandragupta Maurya and established the Mauryan dynasty, which we will learn in the, which will revise, sorry, not learn, you already know about these things in the next video. At this moment, let me give you an idea of the Persian and Greek invasions. Like you all know about the Alexander invasion, but before that too, you must see here the Kamboja and Gandhara in the northwest. And Persian and Greek invasions is the 6th century BC. Persian invasion started. So the Persian Empire at that time was a great empire, first under Darius I, then Xerxes, and Indian satrapies, they become the provinces. Gandhara and present day Pakistan was become a part of the Persian Empire. There is a Behistun inscription of Darius I which attests this. Then Xerxes' army, which when he fought against the Greeks, also has the Indian forces. When Alexander came to India after defeating the Persians, Greeks established their rule in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region. Alexander came to India. He fought against the Porus at the Battle of the Hydaspes or Chelum, and because he already covered so much of area from the Greece to the Indian border, his forces revolted because they heard about the Nanda might. So they said that no, we want to go further and let's move back. So some of his forces moved they came down here to via Indus, and some of them went around the coast, some of them went via the sea route to the Persian Gulf. And on his way back, Alexander died in 323 BC, and he established a number of Alexandria cities in the entire region. That's it. Thank you, guys.